Chapter 17 of The Adventures of a Nature Guide by Enos Mills. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. We could hardly believe our senses, except when hungry or while Father was thrashing us. When I was a boy in Scotland, I was fond of everything that was wild, and all my life I have been growing fonder and fonder of wild places and wild creatures. Naturally inherited wildness in our blood ran free on its glorious course, as invincible and unstoppable as the stars. Nature saw to it that besides school lessons and church lessons, some of her own lessons should be learned. I was only leaving one university for another, the Wisconsin University for the University of the Wilderness. In drying plants, botanists often dry themselves. Dry words and dry facts will not fire hearts. John Muir. Chapter 17, The Development of a Woman Guide. A number of nature guides are women. Their number will increase. Their work is identical with that of men guides. In this chapter are glimpses of some of the field experiences and some of the driving forces of environment that resulted in producing one woman nature guide. The name of this woman is omitted at her request. She's the woman who made the 15-mile moonlight walk across the mountains in the snow, said one of the waiting group, as a young lady in knickerbockers, having adjusted the snowshoes strapped across her shoulders, left the post office. Oh, said another, that was nothing compared with the 30-mile trip which she made alone across the range. Evidently she is a woman with a purpose in life, remarked the postmaster, looking out the window at the graceful figure swinging easily up the street. She came out here from the east last fall, determined to become a good mountaineer, and took up a homestead near McGregor Pass. She knows college and business life and her own mind, and apparently she knows how to walk and enjoy it. Undoubtedly she will make good in her ambitions to succeed out of doors. This homesteader had seen 27 summers, and life had agreed with her. Her hair was red, and so too were her cheeks. She was 5 feet 5 and weighed about 120. She had walked down to the village this November afternoon from her cabin 4 miles away to get the week's accumulated mail and a few provisions. Darkness was already settling down over the pine-purpled mountains when she stopped to make a call. But she was not afraid of the dark. Rather, she enjoyed night walks and walks in all weather. "It is too late for you to think of going home tonight," said Mrs. Pond, when her caller began adjusting her shoulder pack. "It will be dark before you can reach the canyon. Stay with us and go to Mrs. Samuel's card party." "No," was the reply, "I must get home." Then Mr. Pond came in to offer hospitality and advice and to enter objections against her going. He remarked that bears had been recently seen near the canyon. "Well, I'll certainly start at once," said the homesteader, smiling. "I have been wishing I might see a bear." And off she started alone through the snow. And why had this young woman given up business to mountaineer? A consulting decorator for a nationwide business firm, and in love with her job, she overworked and eventually had a nervous breakdown. During the months of enforced rest, she had time to think, and did so. Many things in business life, she had decided, were wearing without seeming really necessary or worthwhile. Once in a routine of work, the average individual ceases to grow, ceases to be the architect of his own fate. She found herself wishing to get away from the city with its exacting demands to a simple form of existence, where money, people, and society were secondary. Then came the opportunity to homestead. It was dark when she reached home from the village. After building a fire, she sat down to read her letters. One was from the New York classmate whom she had invited to share her cabin and her mountain experiences. Her distressed artist friend, after thinking over the matter for a number of weeks, at last wrote, "You are nearly as crazy. Yes, I guess you are a little further gone than I am. Your letter thrilled me to death, I assure you, but being east in a comfortable steam-heated home two stories up, I can't help but wonder how it could be done, and we come out of it alive. I always did and always shall want to come west, but I must say I never quite worked myself up to thinking I could really enjoy living in the midst of the great unknown in a log cabin with one other person, and that person no stronger than myself, with no conveniences, and likely to be completely buried in snow at any minute. Now, if this hadn't been actually put before me as a proposition, my theorizing might picture it the most wonderful experience I could wish for. Yes, I should love to be snowed in, and have wolves howl outside, and get the whole atmosphere thoroughly absorbed into my system, as you probably have done already. I wonder if you have sort of gone crazy about the place, the way those wanderers do who go into the mountains and never come back. If so, I think you need a guardian. You must have some strong person with you, and a dog, a big dog. Where is the nearest doctor? Facts are not pleasant things to rub into your dreams when you're dreaming, but they're mighty pleasant things when you're living." The wild predictions of the city lady, who had no knowledge of the romance of homesteading and was without sympathy for the simple, splendid life that may be lived in the mountain frontier, did not come true. City people and others have listed several absolute necessities for every homesteader: a gun, a dog or a cat, a sewing machine, a Victrola, a telephone, a burro, and, of course, a companion. This independent, individual homesteader possessed none of these so-called essentials, but she had a greater possession than they could have given her. She had happiness. In these lines you have a good glimpse of her life and of herself during her first winter of homesteading. Happiness. "My lot is a strangely happy one, though far from the busy mart. I live on my homestead all alone, with ever a song in my heart. And if perchance I tire of home, away and away I go, to gypsy by a stony brook, or campfire in the snow. When wily wind blows fierce and strong, or cloud and mist allure, I don my very oldest togs, and picnic then for sure. My thoughts are as free as the mountain air, and never a care have I, where I live alone in a little hut, and not even the road goes by." In this mountain frontier, neighbors are separated by magnificent distances. Yet this young woman visited all her homestead neighbors, journeying from 2 to 16 miles on foot. Last Christmas, she and one of the other women homesteaders, who lived 15 miles away, walked to a midway place and had a merry campfire lunch among the pines. Alone, she explored the forests and canyons. She climbed peaks, studied trees, and watched birds, beavers, mountain sheep, and other wild life. All alone, winter as well as summer, she made excursions, camping wherever night overtook her. Sometimes, too, she tramped by moonlight. Many an evening, in a wind-sheltered nook in the woods, she cooked a scanty supper in the edge of a friendly fire. After supper, if there was sufficient wood at hand for the night, she sat for a time, watching the fire and thinking such thoughts as a lone outdoor woman thinks. Often she wandered from the fire, better to have a look at the starry landmarks in the wide and trailless sky. After a few hours of perfect sleep in a sleeping bag, she rose early and eagerly watched for the fires of sunrise from some commanding crag. Her homestead consisted of 120 acres of mountain scenery, much of which is on edge. The land is covered with scattered growths of western yellow pine, Douglas spruce, and quaking aspen, the fairy aspen of which she has written so charmingly. A granite cliff towers several hundred feet above the house. From her front door you look westward up Fall River Canyon and beyond, where the snowy peaks of the Continental Divide go far up into the sky. In front of the house is a garden of a few acres. Just outside her window is a table for birds. Chickadees and camp birds were the only callers while I watched. Occasionally, wild mountain sheep and deer confidingly follow an old game trail near the cabin. The cabin in which she lived alone was called Keewaydin, the Indian name for the northwest or home wind. She drew the plans for it and helped to build it, designed her furniture, and made a number of the pieces. Anyone with a nose for news would have seen a story in the life of this young woman. When I called to get the story, there was more reserve than I expected to find in an art school graduate. "I understand that you helped shingle your house," I said, hoping to start her talking concerning building craft. She smiled and answered, "Yes, the report was out that I shingled as fast as a man, and if it is still circulating, it may be faster now." Knowing that friends had accused her of loafing, of wasting her best years homesteading, I asked, "Have you read Stevenson's Apology for Idlers?" Instantly she flashed up, but with face melting into a smile, replied, "If you really have absorbed it and appreciate it, I'll say yes." And then she added, "But it is not necessary to write a book, create a masterpiece, or evolve some labor-saving device for the recluse to feel justified in separating himself from the affairs of the world. If he values the power that lies in simple things, and the height and breadth of vision that comes from a close contact with nature, that is sufficient. An overpowering desire to get away from the superficialities of life can only be satisfied by taking up that unfettered existence where truth is unvarnished and beauty is undefiled. No, it does not require courage to do what you want to do, to homestead, for instance, but it did take courage to say no to the directing advice of relatives and intimate friends." "And why homestead?" I asked, feeling that she fully appreciated the higher opportunities that go with homesteading. "Our ancestors," she began after a few minutes' thought, "who pioneered either through choice or necessity, labored that their children and their children's children might be better off than themselves. But is it not for each of us to decide anew just what is better for ourselves and for those with whom and for whom we are living of the present and of the future? Does the better off lie in vainly struggling to outdo our neighbors in accumulating possessions? Or will we find it by holding on to those fine, sturdy, fundamental qualities that make for strength of body and happiness of spirit? The test of all effort should be not how much it gives us, but how deeply it makes us live." Realizing that she had carefully considered all sides of the subject, I waited for her to continue. Her views of homesteading were convincing as she disclosed them further. "A homestead offers infinite opportunities for self-development and enjoyment. Here time is the willing slave rather than the compelling master. Here a hobby may be ridden with a reckless abandon or with a prolonged exactitude impossible in the routine of city life. And if your leaning is along the line of nature study, fortunate are you indeed if you have no other companions than those faithful allies of the brain, keen ears and eyes. Who is there who would not enjoy, for a time at least, the unbroken silences and all-enveloping solitude of a hermit's habitation? Who would not appreciate an opportunity to allow the mind and heart to travel together on limitless journeys into the past and future, gathering facts, creating fancies that mold and shape new and bigger conceptions of life. The warm feelings of this woman, whom the world would regard as a self-exile, again and again reminded me of the words of the exile who wrote, "Life's more than breath and the quick round of blood." She is creative and courageous. Her refreshing enthusiasms are colored with high ideals. Of course, she has definite ideas concerning education. She feels that schools are too much given to memorizing and too little to developing the powers of performance, that the senses are neglected, individuality and the creative faculty suppressed, and the wonderlight of imagination extinguished. I was thinking that before long she might do something big, so universal were her sympathies, and I finally asked, "You have become a good mountaineer. You also appreciate the facts and the poetry of natural history. Why not become a translator of the great book of nature?" "For years," she replied, "I have wished that others might have the strange delight from nature that I enjoy. And I have been trying to develop myself so that I might give its appeal to people." "This can be done," I said. "You are fitted for a guiding career." The outings which she enjoyed usually were made alone, and sometimes they were adventurous. The nearest settlement on the other side of the Continental Divide is 30 miles away. This is reached by trail, a trip across the summit, 12,500 feet above the sea, and then down through 15 miles of rugged, forested mountains. She resolved to make this journey afoot and without a guide. She had been on the summit midwinter, but this snowshoe trip was less eventful than her spring experience. It was a trip that few men had made alone, and local people had concluded that a woman could not make it if she tried. Her success literally startled the natives both sides of the divide. It was late spring, and the winter accumulations of snow were soft, melting rapidly and flooding water everywhere. Snowdrifts and soggy places full of flowers covered the steep and dangerously slippery slopes. But she reached the summit by noon. After eating a lunch on these heights, more than 1,000 feet above the limits of tree growth, she started down the icy steeps into unknown wilds. She crossed the debris of recent land and snow slides. Everything was slippery, slipping, or ready to slide. But she came down to timberline without starting anything and without a slide herself. Then, for 10 miles, the trail led through deep snowdrifts and swollen streams. She crossed on doubtful logs. Sometimes, with the logs under water, she hitched across astride the log in the roaring current. In places, she waded to her knees. Just as darkness was settling down, all bedraggled but enthusiastic, she arrived at the end of her journey. She took a longer, less perilous way returning, a 2-day trip that gave her new, though less rugged, scenes. This outdoor woman had a purpose, a vision. Daily she accumulated experience and information. These she handled like an artist. She held on to the essentials only and made these enrich her life. Then, too, she had wide sympathies, and in improving her opportunities to learn and grow it, was with the idea of being able to serve others. She had steadily developed since the day she arrived. She had secured leisure and had used it. Last summer, she was a nature guide, an interpreter of nature, in the Rocky Mountain National Park, licensed by the government. Old people gave her their attention. Children were excitedly interested, and everyone was exercising and learning all at once. A trip with a nature guide is a rare influence for children. Eagerly they look and they listen. They see, they search, and they think. It is an alluring and most effective way of arousing the child mind so that it wants to know, so that it starts investigating and exploring, so that it insists on finding out. This new occupation is likely to be far-reaching in its influences. It is inspirational and educational. Anyone who has a vacation or an outing in contact with nature will have from the great outdoors its higher values as well as a livelier enjoyment if accompanied by a nature guide. Many of the visitors to national parks are nature enthusiasts. They can appreciate having someone out with them who can interpret some of the wealth of local nature lore. There is geology, the story of the glacial landscapes, the ways of resident birds, and the birds that come from Southland for summer and to nest, beaver houses, bighorn mountain sheep, brilliant Arctic flowers, the habits of trees, and the romance of everything. Although everyone has inherited outdoor instincts, which awaken with opportunity, yet so long have most people been segregated from contact with the primeval, wild flowers, wild life, and crumbling, half-vine-concealed cliffs, that they welcome an intelligent and tactful interpreter of nature's ways. Such a guide enriches the outing, fills it with information, enjoyment, and vision. A nature guide is doing the work of the world. Our homesteader had the art and the vision which enabled her to make these outings permanent, purposeful, growth-compelling experiences. They had none of the movie madness, nor the legend-diverting magic, but they gave a definite contact with the real world of life. Nature-guided excursions are educational and possess astounding possibilities for arousing the feelings and developing the unlimited resources of the mind. No, this young woman was not wasting her time homesteading. It enriched her life, filled it with eagerness and delight. To miss the joy is to miss all, says Stevenson in his immortal Lantern Bearers. She is not missing it. The world may not know it, but she is as happy as Stevenson's boy with the precious hidden lantern on his belt. In the work of nature guiding, she has found her place. End of chapter 17. A note on chapter 17. The woman described, Esther Burnell, became Enos Mills' wife. The end of The Adventures of a Nature Guide by Enos Mills, read for LibriVox by Sue Anderson. Please visit my website at audiobooks.olive and seablue.com. Thank you, Sue.